Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is June 5th, 2016. Today is the third Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Sunday after Pentecost, which is the birthday of the church. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, we're singing the hymn, O Worship the King. It was written by Robert Grant. He lived, he wrote it in 1833, or Worship the King. He's comparing the King of England. He's an Anglican governor. He was the governor of Bombay, India, an official in the Worship the King. He's comparing God's kingship with the King of England.
Thank you. preserve the human family of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Deliver us from the death of sin, and raise us to new life in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
May be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Diane Myers will be doing the first reading.
Judaism. I was violently persecuting the Church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I was far more zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who had set me apart before I was born and called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son to me so that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles. I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were already apostles before me. But I went away at once into Arabia, and afterwards I returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years I did go up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stayed with him 15 days. But I did not see any other apostle except James, the Lord's brother. In what I am writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard it said, the one who formerly was persecuting us is now proclaiming the faith he once tried to destroy. And they glorified God because of me. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Now sing the gospel acclamation.
Gospel acclamation. Pastor John Pollock is our pastor. He will be reading the gospel. The gospel today has to do with the raising of a person from the dead. And this is our assurance to eternal life. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're glad to have you here watching us on YouTube. We'd love to have you in person with some of the best people in Clark County.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 7th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went with him. As he approached the gate of the town, a man who had died was being carried out. He was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. With her was a large crowd from the town. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion for her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came forward and touched the bier, and the bier stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, rise." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized all of them, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us, and God has looked favorably on his people." This word about him spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding country. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Another thing to notice during this summer season is sometimes when we have music at the drive-in, they will come back to sing at 10:30. And so each week you will have, as you see the bulletin, special music for Hymn Below. So this morning we are singing the Hymn Below. We not only do not have special music for now, but they didn't show up at the drive-in either. So, "When Morning Gilds the Sky," it's hymn 853 in the back of your worship.
Hymn "Morning Gilds the Sky" is anonymous as far as the writer. It first appeared in a Catholic hymn book called Catholicus Dashiach, and it appeared in 1744. It's an old hymn, but nobody knows who wrote it. It was translated about 100 years later, but it's in a Catholic hymn book. Catholicus Dashiach was German and then translated into Latin, and now it's English, "When Morning Gilds the Sky." A beautiful song. It was translated by Joseph Barnaby. And it's a beautiful morning today. Morning gilds the sky. Jesus, we're praising Jesus Christ. And we're seeing Jesus in the speaking to the woman at the well. She was one of the first evangelists. Jesus spoke to a Samaritan woman. He picked people out as ones that needed him, and those are the ones he came to, those in need.
We are faced with a game of
Christian faith that is true. And what I mean by that is, even though Christianity is often put in the same group as the, when talking about religion, we talk about the five great religions of the world, Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Buddhism, and Hinduism. Christianity in reality is not a religion. It is a faith. And the difference is, because some people of a religion will say, well, we have faith in what we believe, and why aren't we a faith? Well, the difference is, in a religion, religion is based on individuals or a group of individuals trying to reach up to God. It is a group of people who have come together and agreed on a certain book of laws and rules and rituals and traditions, and the belief that by doing those, they will earn themselves up into paradise or an afterlife, whatever. On the other hand, the emphasis is on the person. The emphasis is on you doing good works. On the other hand, Christianity, the emphasis is not on us trying to reach up to God. It is God reaching out to us. It is the God of grace seeking us, not us seeking the God of grace. The emphasis is not on what we do, but on what God has done. And so the choice is, do you want to follow a salvation of works righteousness, or do you want to follow a gospel of grace? And it is this idea of grace and the gospel of grace that St. Paul is using in our second reading for today as proof that Christianity is the gospel truth. That Christianity is the gospel truth concerning how to have a relationship with God, how to have your sins forgiven, and how to be assured of everlasting life. So if you haven't already done so, you can take your sermon notes out and let us examine Galatians 1, 11 through 24. At least one of the questions you should have already answered on your sermon notes, and that's that there are 4,200 religions. 4,200 religions, but one faith. Faith in Jesus Christ. So, Paul begins in verse 11 by making the point that the gospel of grace is the true gospel because it is God's message, not a human message. For I would have you know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. So Paul begins his defense or his argument by saying, I would have you know. This word know, or phrase would know, means a certainty. It means to know with certainty, to know with confidence, to know from a personal interaction or a firsthand interaction with the situation. So St. Paul is saying, first of all, the gospel message is true because I've had a first-hand interaction. And I can tell you with all certainty, I can tell you with all confidence that what I'm telling you is true. Because I did not receive it from any human order. And again, this separates Christianity from the religions of the world. In the religions of the world, you usually have, and for the most part, you have a book that they follow that was written by one person. The Quran was written by Muhammad, supposedly. Buddhism, they follow the teachings of Buddha. In Mormonism, they follow the Book of Mormon, which was supposedly written by Joseph Smith, or translated by Joseph Smith, from some bronze plates that he received, that he hid behind a curtain and read to some translators what was there. Of course, now these plates have never been found. And we have all kinds of copies of the books of the Bible. We have all kinds of copies of the Quran. We have all kinds of copies of the writings of Buddha. We have copies of what Confucius said. We've never found these plates that supposedly the Book of Mormon came from. So that's the difference. A religion usually has one person wrote the book that he followed. The Christian Bible was written by, at a minimum, 36 writers. Scholars now believe it's probably more like 40 different writers, because it's pretty well been agreed on that Hebrews was not written by St. Paul, as it used to be thought. And there are some other books in the Old Testament, New Testament, that they think someone else wrote instead of the person whose name is there. So the difference is we have at least 36 different writers who contributed to the Bible. It covered 16 centuries. It's written in both Hebrew and Greek. And yet, from the very first book, Genesis, to the very last book, the book of Revelation, the story is the same. The teaching is the same. The proclamation is the same. And the only way that was possible was by God, through the Holy Spirit, dictating to the writers what to write. They could not just come up with this themselves. And so he says that the gospel was not man's gospel. That means it was not in the domain or the control of man. If it was man-made, it would look like all the other religions of the world. The emphasis would be on works righteousness. The emphasis would be on you abiding by and observing certain festivals, certain traditions, certain rituals, certain laws, and these would guide your life. The gospel is not like that. The gospel talks about salvation through faith. So he says, goes on and says, he received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. That word revelation means an unveiling of something previously secret. Something which had not been known. See, when St. Paul had his experience on the Damascus Road, as he will go on and tell us, and after Ananias baptized him, and after he began to associate with the Christian community, he then went off. And Jesus instructed him, the resurrected Lord Jesus instructed him himself. He revealed to him, he unveiled for him the true gospel that he was to proclaim to the Gentiles. So this was all revealed to him by Jesus Christ, and what he is saying, without putting it in direct words, is that there is no way he could have made this gospel up. He was a Pharisee. He was a Pharisee among Pharisees. He had been one of the famous Rabbi Gamaliel's best. He believed in the law. The law was the way you were justified. Obeying every dot and tittle of the law. So a person with this background could not suddenly come up and believe that God was not giving you salvation through the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ, his son, who had fulfilled the law. And so he is saying, we know this is the truth because it is God's message. God had everything to do with it. So then he goes on to share with us about his life before he became Paul, the missionary and evangelist. For you have heard of my former life, my former behavior in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently, and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people, so extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my father. That word destroy means to ravage or to lay waste. It is the imagery of a barbarian horde going through a village and leaving nothing left behind. Destroying everything. It's like with the Romans did when they conquered Carthage found and defeated Hannibal. They tore down Carthage and then sowed, plowed salt in the land so that nothing could grow for years, so that Carthage could not be reestablished. It's like what the SS did to the village of Lidice in Czechoslovakia, or the old Czechoslovakia, after the assassination of Reinhard Heydrich, the Nazi protectorate of Bohemia, and second in command of the SS to Himmler. When word got out that one of the assassins had been from Lidice, the Nazis went in and totally leveled the village so there was nothing left and killed all the inhabitants. That's what Jesus, or St. Paul is saying. He was trying to do the church as Saul the Pharisee. He was trying to totally waste it, ravage it, so nothing would be left. How would someone like this become the greatest missionary and theologian of the Christian church? It's because the gospel has the power to change lives. You can take a group of criminals, thugs, derelicts, degenerates, and you can read to them all day and all night for weeks until you're blue in the face. Read to them Aristotle, and Plato, and Socrates, and Nietzsche, Bertrand Russell, and they're never going to change. But you share with them the good news of Jesus Christ, and those same people have dramatic change as they become a follower of our Lord. So St. Paul tells us that here he was, this Pharisee, hating the church, not knowing that all along, from the very beginning, God had selected him to be this great missionary to the Gentiles, this great theologian. Think about that for a moment. Here you have the original apostles, the original 11. Judas betrayed him, comes, hanged himself, he's gone, he's out of the picture. Matthias has taken his place. But you take the original 11. They've been with Jesus from the, they were with Jesus from the beginning. 3 years they spent with him in his public ministry. They witnessed his resurrection and he appeared to them over and over again before his ascension. And yet none of them become the greatest missionary and theologian in the church. Instead, it's Saul, a Pharisee, a hater of the church, a destroyer of the church. This shows the power of what God can do through faith in Jesus Christ. This is why it is so important to teach Jesus Christ to people. Because Jesus changes lives. But verse 15, but when he who had set me apart, meaning God, set me apart means to separate me, to select me, to devote me to a purpose. But when he who had set me apart before I was born, and who called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone. But when God, who set me apart, that is to separate, select, devote for purpose, before I was born, who called me, that means to appoint someone to something, or to have a divine invitation. So St. Paul said, before I was even born, even though I went on this path of being a Pharisee and hating the church, God had already separated me, selected me, devoted me to this purpose of being an evangelist for the church and a missionary and theologian. He called me, that is, gave me this divine invitation all through his grace. You see, St. Paul wasn't looking for the God of grace, but the God of grace was looking for St. Paul. And it's the same today. People aren't looking for the God of grace, but the God of grace is looking for them. And the God of grace is expecting us to share that good news of Jesus with those who are unchurched and those who are not part of the community of faith so that they can come in. And he was pleased to reveal his son. Here the word reveal means to expose what had been hidden or to remove the veil. St. Paul didn't know Jesus. He just knew about him. He wanted to destroy him. But now Jesus exposes himself to him, removes the veil in the relationship between the two, so that St. Paul can now become Paul the Apostle, as he sees. sees that Jesus Christ really is the Messiah, that Jesus Christ really is the Savior of the world. So the conversion of St. Paul proves the truth of the gospel. Paul's salvation was the work of God through Jesus Christ. There was nothing that St. Paul did. There was nothing that he contributed to his salvation. It was all done by God. And God still does it today. And God still calls people to do things in his church at various ages and at various times. You never know when Jesus is going to call you to an appointment, give you a divine invitation for a purpose that you were called to before you were even born. So the gospel is more than God saving you from hell. The gospel is enabling you to have a personal relationship in which God reveals himself to you in Jesus Christ. This is why it's important to teach Jesus Christ. At the assembly yesterday, our Bible study was led by one of the systematic teachers and professors of systematic theology at Trinity Lutheran Seminary in Columbus. And she was talking about our misconceptions of evangelism and how the churches start shrinking. They start panicking and trying to evangelize it. The typical way of trying to evangelize is you go out and try to sell people on your church. You tell them, well, you want to come to our church because we have this wonderful music program. We have these great musicians and beautiful voices. Or you want to come to our church because we have a gym and we have a bowling alley and we have all these things for people to do. Or like what we would say to someone, well, you should come and join us at St. John because we're very active in the community. We have a food pantry once a week. We have a free meal on Fridays for anyone, from the poor, the homeless, anybody that wants to show up. We have a thrift store that's open 4 out of 5 work days. We also do other things to support the community and to help the homeless and those who are hungry. And we have a gym and a fellowship hall that we rent out to different groups so they can use them for things. She said, that's not evangelism. So what you need to do is teach people about Jesus. That you need to develop that confidence in the Holy Spirit. When you find somebody who's not going to church, that you don't sit there and say, oh, we'll come to my church because we have services at this time and that time. You tell them about Jesus and what Jesus meant in your life and means in your life. So that's what St. Paul's telling the Galatians. This is what St. Peter said on that first Pentecost. On that first Pentecost, 3,000 people became members of the Christian church. They didn't have an experience like St. Paul. They didn't get the resurrected Lord to become blind and then have somebody several days later baptize them and the scale-like things fall from their eyes. They simply heard Jesus. Heard about Jesus. Were taught Jesus. Were taught what Jesus has done for them. And they said, what must we do to be saved? St. Peter said, baptize and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we always must be awake for the opportunity to share Jesus with others. We must always be aware of the Holy Spirit calling us to a new venture in order to spread the good news of Jesus. It's not that hard to tell someone Jesus died for your sins and the sins of the world. That he died so that you could come to him no matter how desperate you are, no matter how sinful you are, no matter what a mess your life has been. He died so that you can come to him. And that you may be forgiven of all those sins. And that you have that grace of everlasting life to spend eternity in his kingdom. So the gospel truth is that Jesus is indeed the way, the truth, and the life. That no one comes to the Father except through him. But we have share that old story of Jesus and his love with those who have not heard. We have to share that old story of Jesus and his love with this world that is hurting and chasing after 4,200 religions instead of coming to salvation through faith. So St. Paul shows us that we never know at what age God may call us into a special venture. That we never know at what time in our life God may make a radical change in our life. And St. Paul also shows us that when he does call us, that we can have that confidence that he will see us through that adventure and equip us with what we need so we can indeed share that old story of Jesus and his love. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
For our offering, and our ushers today are Carol Glaze and Helen Wallace. Our reader was Diane Myers. Communion assistant is Sally Baker. We have Holy Communion today. You see the acolyte bringing the plates forward. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We invite you to come worship with us. We worship God just as He commanded us to. We receive His Holy Spirit. We receive body and blood. We receive eternal life. What kind of a deal is this? We can come, we can receive eternal life, or we can die. So why would we want to die when we can receive eternal life with Jesus Christ? All we have to do is believe, accept Him, and we have a relationship with God. Through His Holy Spirit, we believe in the true body and blood of Jesus Christ. He's with us forever. He died on the cross so that He could be with us, so that we can have the Holy Spirit. We have our drive-in service every Sunday at 8 o'clock at Melody Cruise-In Drive-In. We invite you to come worship with us. 8 o'clock from Memorial Day through Labor Day. And then we have services here now in the sanctuary at 10:30. We praise God. We worship God just as He commanded us to. And He is here with us. He says if two or three are gathered together in His name, He is with us. We have worship service at 6:30 p.m. and in chapel. Rainbow Table, this is at 12 o'clock on Fridays. Drive-in service at 8 o'clock. We have Sunday school, parables classes, having Sunday school in the chapel every Sunday at 9:15. You see the ushers now are forward, and we're starting with Holy Communion, where we really see the true body and blood of Jesus Christ, who said, "This is my body, this is my blood." The mystery of Holy Communion, where we receive His entire body and blood with us, and He is going to restore us and give us eternal life.
One body, and we're all around the altar.
So that everyone who believes in Him may not perish but have thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant, my blood shed given for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering that from his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we're able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit, to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we, and all who share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Stand Up, Stand Up for Jesus, printed on the back page of the bulletin. Stand Up, Stand Up for Jesus, on the back of the bulletin.
This hymn was written in 1858. It was written by George Duffield Jr., and he wrote it in memory of Dudley Ting, T-Y-N-G. Dudley Ting, in 1858, died, and his last words were, stand up for Jesus. He was a minister, an Episcopal minister in Philadelphia. He stood up against slavery, and he was kicked out of the church. He then founded the YMCA, and 1,000 people became converted in one day, 1,000 men. He was involved in a terrible accident, but his last words were, stand up for Jesus. We should stand up for Jesus too. Must not suffer loss. St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime. Click on, put in Google, YouTube, and click on to the videos. Watch whatever video you like. We are videoing every service. We're happy to bring you this service. We offer a Christian school program, ages 3 and 4, nursery and pre-K. For information, call the school office, 325-4311. That's 325-4311. Please tune in anytime. Thanks for joining our worship service. God will continue to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you, continue to pray for us, and for our YouTube ministry. Come and worship with us anytime. We'd love to have you. Jesus, God is here with us. You can feel his presence. You can have eternal life. What a great gift. Come and receive eternal life. Receive Jesus Christ within you. Become one with everybody who loves God. And all we have to do is believe.